What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Press X Podcast, episode 48, your weekly podcast for nerdy news and opinions coming at you each and every Monday at noon Eastern. I'm Kevin McManus. With me, Kellen Williard.
Hola.
And Nick Hassell.
That's me.
So we're going to do not a different show, but this is going to be a very news-focused show because we have so much to talk about. The Game Awards happened. PSX happened. So we'll do what we're playing. We'll try to keep it as brief as possible. We'll do the news, which is just going to consist of us going over announcements, and then we can stop and talk about ones that we want to talk about. We may not do questions, depending on how long that takes. We'll do the game releases, and we may not do the unpopular opinion, once again, depending on how long that takes. So, with that said, we can start out with what we've been playing. Kellen.
What?
You and your PlayStation loving self. What have you been playing?
Not that thing. Mostly just Pokemon, League of Legends. Watched a bunch of movies over Thanksgiving break. Mm-hmm. The usual stuff.
What's the best movie you saw?
I mean, I watched all six of the Star Wars, so.
So, episode five.
Yeah.
Episode five. That's about it. Pokemon League.
Just hanging out.
Yeah. Not much.
You also watched a bunch of anime with me.
Well, I
since
didn't
I
count.
Guess we're covering 2 weeks.
It's true.
Finished Pokemon Sun, I guess if it matters. Best Pokemon game ever released. Nice
really?
And short.
That is not the consensus.
Also played Final Fantasy 15 a lot. I've got about 22 hours, which is pretty good for Tuesday to Sunday. Not bad. Really like it.
You
really
like
fun
it?
Game. Can't wait to play more.
So I have kind of a weird one. I beat Pokemon Moon for the extent and purpose. I'm done with that game. I don't think I'm ever getting another Pokemon game. It was fine. I like collecting the things. I don't really like the combat very much, so I got bored of it. But I put 30 hours into it or something. I've been working on Zero Escape still. I think I might have that beaten next week. I'm getting close.
Maybe.
Yeah. I'm liking it a lot.
Are you buying the watch?
I got it. I'm liking it a lot. And then the surprise one, Assassin's Creed Syndicate. So I'm like 20 hours into Assassin's Creed Syndicate, and I like this game.
That's really
random. I got it for $8 on Black Friday, because I was like, why not? Really like the idea of, I just like the setting. The Victorian London, I love that setting. It's like The Order, except The Order sucked. So I'm glad that there's something
so
decent. No, it doesn't suck.
Okay.
It's good.
Like The Order, which sucks, so...
No, the setting is like The Order.
Oh.
There's some things that they do that are really cool, and I wish that this was the Assassin's Creed game that they took the break from and then released, because I think it could have been a really, really good game, because it still has bugs. Its worst problems, its controls. The climbing in Assassin's Creed is terrible. You're like, I want to go here, and then your character like jumps behind you and grabs onto a lamp, and you're like, what are you doing?
Get off the lamp.
Why are
that's
you on that?
That's a small knock against Final Fantasy that I have. It's one button does 30 things.
Yes.
So
that is the problem, the exact problem that I have with Assassin's Creed. Circle kidnaps people, but it also hijacks cars, but it also frees the people that are being kidnapped. So like you have to throw somebody into the back of a carriage and you go to do it and your character moves a little bit and then you free them and then you go to grab them again and you hijack the carriage and start driving off and the person's just running in the opposite direction.
Wait, come back.
I'm like, what are you doing?
And it's not something you can like map and change because like even
it's
if you
same
do like square
button.
Is there's like five things next to it. So.
The only other thing that I want to say about it that I really like is one, you have two assassins that you can switch between that have like some special abilities that I think is pretty cool. And two, I really like that as you take over territory off the map, the people in that territory respect you and you can recruit them to like follow you like a posse. And then you can sick them after people and you can level them up. So you can make them so that they take like fighting things and they're all stronger, or they can bribe the police so that the police stop going after you. It's very like Grand Theft Auto in that way. The police will go after you and things.
Yeah, they've been doing that for a little while.
You can get it to bribe them so that they won't go after you, and then you can get it so that the kids will pickpocket people and give you the items and stuff. It's just kind of neat. So I'm actually enjoying that. I'll have that beaten for sure. I'm probably towards the end of it. I think there's 9 chapters or something. I'm on the 6th one, so getting there. All right, so let's move into the big stuff. The Game Awards, PSX. We're just going to go through all the announcements. I have the Game Awards first because it happened first, and I actually just have them pulled up here. Hopefully it doesn't fuck up the audio. So here we go. I don't think we're going to talk too much about the actual winners of the thing. Oh, we can talk about Game of the Year, but I don't think any of them really matter too
They were
much.
Also terrible categories. Whoever...
No, they've always had terrible categories. Yeah. I don't know what's wrong with them, but they're like, sports slash racing is like one, and they're like, okay, and then it's like, most... what's the one that they're like... Most influent, like it influences people the most.
Impact game.
Yeah, and I'm like, what does this mean?
How do you pick that?
You're just making things up.
Well, and the even the Game of the Year awards was, it looked like they were trying to pick exclusives. It felt like they always do kind of like exclusives.
I mean, there's
throw an indie game in there.
Well, it was Inside.
Yeah, that's the indie game.
Yeah, I yes, Inside, Uncharted 4,
yeah,
Titanfall 2,
yeah,
Overwatch,
yeah.
And I think they're in Doom, I think.
Yeah.
So there's Doom. One exclusive.
I know. It just feels like they always try to do that.
I think that was the thing.
Because Overwatch is kind
know.
Of PC exclusive. I mean, it's on consoles, but you're never going to see them in tournaments. And they don't really care as much about it. So that's kind of the PC game. Doom, Titanfall is kind of the Xbox stuff. PS4, Uncharted. I don't know, it's just sort of like, it's just weird. Like,
I think they were terrible.
Yeah, why
so everybody was like, where's The Witness? That's like going to be IGN's Game of the Year.
Yeah,
and I'm sure they were like, what are you doing?
Where's The Witness? Where's Gears if you're going to do this sort of exclusive
thing?
Yeah, because
Gears fit the cutoff as well.
I
don't know.
Dude, just weird choices. And it wasn't just that category. It was
all the categories were very weird. But I'm very happy Pokemon Go won mobile game.
Well, what else would have won it? Like?
And family friendly.
Fire Emblem Fates. Which should have won.
Oh, mobile game.
Yeah.
I was thinking cell phone, but I guess that counts.
Yeah, well, they said mobile, yeah. I think it was mobile and anyway, let's talk about announcements. The first one, Bulletstorm Full Clip. This is, I believe, being published by the Borderlands team. They came out. I was expecting Borderlands 3. This is not Borderlands 3. I don't care at all about this game.
Nope.
The big reveal to get people to buy it is that Duke Nukem is a fully playable character, fully voiced.
Yeah.
I don't care. You like Duke Nukem.
Hell yeah, I like Duke Nukem. But it's not enough for me. What was it, 40?
I think it's 40.
Yeah, no. I don't like that much.
The first announcement, and definitely my favorite, was Death Stranding. Got another trailer. It's just as weird as the first full one. And there are some weird Easter eggs in it. I don't know if you've looked into any of these or you've seen any
of these.
I've
seen a couple, yeah.
But, so, very strange. The baby's back in a machine thing this time.
Like a little pod.
Because the guy plugged something into it, and the baby's back. And then there's a baby doll that looks like Snake. Like, it's got one eye, and it's got the blue eye, and it's got a shrapnel in its head. And it's floating down the river, and then it hits... Dr. Strange, who looks straight out of Dr. Strange because he's got the eye glowing stuff going on, the black eyes. I don't know what this game is.
No.
But I'm very excited to figure it out.
Yeah.
Something cool about this was if you play the old trailer and this trailer side by side, some things match up. The music overlays each other. The baby... that disappeared in the first trailer goes to the other guy. He plugs the thing in and hits the button, and then the baby appears, and it gets, like, teleported from one side to the other. There's some, like, characters that line up, some architecture and things that line up. It was neat.
Yeah.
Kojima, that's...
Is he even making a game, or is he just making trailers?
I kind of just hope he's... Well, the thing is, this game is 2019 earliest.
It's 3 years off.
Yeah. Earliest.
Yeah.
We're probably going to get one of these trailers... for a long time.
Every 6 months.
I wouldn't be surprised if there's five of them and all of them, you can play all of them at the same time and they all line up and tell some sort of weird story.
Well, didn't this guy look exactly like Guillermo del Toro?
He looks a lot like him, but I wouldn't say exactly. Everybody was cheering when he turned around. And I was like, kind of, like, but
you got some nice touch-ups for
and Del Toro tweeted out that night, I believe, that Konami is the most moronic company ever to abandon Silent Hill after the success of PT. Like, that was his actual tweet. And I'm like, I like this man.
Didn't he do a fuck Konami thing, too? At the
probably.
End of it? Yeah. The hashtag everywhere now.
So that was fantastic.
That on top of Jeff Keighley's long emotional
They're really good friends, Keighley and Kojima. And he finally got to, he goes, he was robbed of this moment last year. He should have been here last year, should have been able to accept Metal Gear Solid's awards, all the stuff. They wouldn't let him. So he's like, I tried to give him the award. He didn't want it. I guess he doesn't even want to be associated with them anymore, which is acceptable.
Fair, yeah.
And then he gave him another one of their awards, which was like developer. I don't know.
Industry leader or something.
Industry
like
leader.
That,
Okay. I mean, he probably deserves that, but sure.
Random. Yeah.
So anyway, Death Stranding, I'm very excited about. We did a thing last week or 2 weeks ago, maybe, that was what game, if we could have any announced game and play it like right now, what would it be? Mine would still be Kingdom Hearts 3, but Death Stranding's probably the second one, just because I'm like, what is this?
Don't know, yeah.
I would like to
maybe
know.
Maybe you should just stick to movies. Short animated
features.
Well,
he wants to do movies, too. He originally wanted to do movies and settled for games, and I think he wants to work with Del Toro in a movie, and this is kind of the beginnings of that. I wouldn't be surprised if within 15 years there's a Kojima movie. Next up, Guardians of the Galaxy Telltale series. This was leaked a month and a half ago.
Yeah, something like that.
There's a voice actor strike going on. We didn't talk about it because it's a complicated situation, and I don't really know how I feel about it. But there's a bunch of high-profile voice actors. They have a blacklist of games that they will not work on. This is on the blacklist.
Brilliant.
So we'll see how that goes.
Mm-hmm.
I imagine, because it is specifically Marvel, and I think it's in the MCU, I would imagine it's going to be Batista and all them, or at least sound alikes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think they're looking for, Nolan North to be doing any voice acting in this, but I don't know. It was just a title and some music.
Yeah.
So
made up for it with the trailer, though, for the actual second movie coming out.
Didn't watch it. Dauntless. I don't know what this is.
Mm-mm.
It's a PC crowd game that a lot of people like on PC. It's coming into console, PlayStation exclusive on consoles. I don't know what this game is. They showed it here, apparently, and then they showed it at the PSX as well. So it's something that they care about. It reminds me a little bit of Paragon, not with gameplay or anything, but just like that's how I feel about it. I'm like, I don't really know what this is doing on a console, but they have a Dauntless trailer. Looks fine. I don't care. They did the Doom music, which was really weird.
It was really good, though. Even though
it was good. I love Doom soundtrack.
Yeah,
but it was just.
I'm not used to seeing people music, rocking out to it.
The music choices there was just really bizarre and conflicting. Yeah. They had a lot of like metal music, and then they had like rap showing up. But it was, I don't know.
It was Run the Jewels and then some other group, which I'm really surprised because they didn't bleep any of it out.
Oh, no, they don't care.
Yeah, I thought they would have, because, some of those bands...
Anything goes.
Anything,
maybe, I don't know, did you watch, a YouTube stream or a Twitch stream?
Twitch, yeah.
Yeah, I wonder if I don't know if they even showed it on TV this year. Usually Spike has it.
I doubt it. I don't think he...
If they did,
yeah,
I imagine it would be bleeped there, obviously. But I think because it's the internet, anything goes. So then we got Prey.
Yeah.
I'm interested in Prey, but it's probably one of those games similar to Gears, similar to Deus Ex, where I'm like, I'm interested in it, but I feel like I'm never going to have time for it, and then over time, I just kind of forget about it. That's what this game is to me. I liked their last trailer, the E3 Bethesda trailer, I believe.
Yeah.
Better, because it reminded me a lot of Bioshock, and that sort of...
It still looks like Bioshock a
lot. A little bit.
Yeah, we'll see.
I don't know. I liked original Prey a lot more, so I'm
I don't know anything about Prey. Yeah. This is...
Old Prey was sweet.
All intents and purposes, this is new to me.
Mm-hmm.
So. Jesus Christ. The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, they had two trailers for. The first one wasn't really anything, though. It was more like, hey, this is going to be here, so pay attention. In Nintendo fashion, guys sitting on a couch, playing the game on the Wii U.
Yeah.
Nothing interesting to me. I've talked about before, I'm not a big Zelda fan. Nothing that caught my interest about it, except for that it looked like it was running terribly.
I think they screwed up. The pre-show, they showed like an actual trailer, like, hey, this is some of the stuff coming, and then they showed dudes on a couch during the event. I think you should have swapped it. Well, I think dudes on the couch should have been pre-show.
Dudes on the couch was the last announcement last year.
Yeah.
It was Miyamoto on the couch with the off-screen footage. They didn't even show the footage. It was off-screen, and people had to skew it on YouTube to try and make a full-screen thing. And that's when he was like, when you ride on a horse, it won't run into trees, because a real horse wouldn't run into trees. And I'm like, thank you, Miyamoto.
Congratulations,
yeah. Yeah.
I know not to run into stuff.
And those guys were terrible at the game.
Yeah. And that
real
was kind
bad.
Of the joke. They're like, oh, let's go in head first. Well, he was too strong for us. I'm going to try stealth. Well, he was too strong for us.
Yeah, I don't know. Hire someone who knows how to play video games.
No, they showed it on the Wii U, which I knew they had to do because, A, they said they're not talking about the Switch. But, B, if you show it on the Switch, people are going to be like, well, what about my Wii U? What about the thing I can buy this year for Christmas?
Yeah.
They still want to sell Wii U's. But it, to me, it looked like its frame rate was terrible.
It was awful. Like, and it wasn't like Twitch, YouTube.
No, it was bad.
Yeah.
So I'm concerned about getting that game on the Wii U because I'm going to... I get the flagship Zelda games, even though I'm not a giant fan. I literally picked up Twilight Princess HD for Black Friday because it was a good price and it came with an amiibo. But I get the Zelda games. I play them. I don't beat them all, but I play them. And I don't know if I'm going to get this for the Wii U if I don't have a Switch. Like, if I have a Switch, I'll get it for that. But if I end up not wanting a Switch and this comes out and it plays like that... Like, that's no good. If it's, like, Hyrule Warriors on the 3DS, which does not run.
Yeah.
You have to have, like, a new 3DS for it to run. I might pass.
I wouldn't buy it for the Wii. Like, I would just leave it out there as sort of, like, bait to make me buy the Switch whenever it comes out.
Yeah, that's fair. Though, the only thing is, like, the GameCube version of Twilight Princess was actually the better version.
Yeah.
And if the Switch has some sort of stupid gimmick to it, like the motion controls on the Wii... this could actually end up being, assuming that they fix the frame rate issues,
functions.
This could be the better version of the game.
Yeah.
And it will definitely be the rarer version to get. Next up, something that made me happy, Shovel Knight, Spectre of Torment. We've known about this expansion. They finally showed it off. You get to play, it's a prequel apparently, you play as Spectre Knight. The levels are 100% redone, the bosses are 100, like everything's totally different. It's like they made a new game. As opposed to the last one, which was Plague Knight, which was very similar, but they just added a couple things and added areas for him to get to specifically because he jumps diagonally, which was a different play style. So they'd add a platform here so you're able to do some different things. This looks like a completely different game.
Yeah, I just call that DLC versus expansion. I mean, a lot of people use them interchangeably.
I mean, it's an expansion for sure. And I don't know if it's going to be standalone, but I wouldn't be surprised. Also, I think it's free.
It looked like it had cool art, so that'd be cool.
Yeah, I think it's free for everybody who has the game, too, because it's still one of those Kickstarter stretch goals. They're still hitting their stretch goals.
Yeah, they got a lot to do.
For Kickstarter. A lot of people are still waiting for the gender bent mode, which is interesting, where Shovel Knight becomes a girl and Shovel Knight becomes a dude. I'm like, okay. I don't know how they didn't do that one quickly, but
whatever.
That seems
easier, yeah.
Yeah. Halo Wars 2 got a premiere, like, story trailer. I guess they had a story trailer, but it got another story trailer.
Yeah.
And they had an announcement that Halo Wars 1 is available for Xbox One.
Yeah.
I'm not a Halo Wars guy, so you can go ahead and take the reins, but...
I've already got that pre-ordered. Looks good.
Halo Wars 2.
That video was really long. It was like six minutes.
It was pretty long. I watched that one.
Yeah, I was playing Assassin's Creed on my Vita the whole time. I was remote playing it, and I was watching the conference on my Xbox on YouTube, and I played a lot of Assassin's Creed during this trailer because I don't care about Halo Wars.
Yeah, it was pretty long. It looks interesting. I'm excited for it.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah.
I want to see gameplay, though.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah, and then it says Halo Wars Definitive Edition. We got a Walking Dead trailer, Walking Dead New Frontier, new Telltale Walking Dead game. I beat season one, liked it, beat season two, liked it even more. Wasn't interested in season three, but they're making it called a New Frontier. They time jumped a lot, and they're releasing chapter one and chapter two together because it's like a two-parter, I guess. It's so much to tell in this opening, which is interesting.
Oh, yeah.
And they showed Clementine grown up, and I was like, oh, that hits me right here, because I do like Clementine quite a bit.
Fair.
A little game called Mass Effect Andromeda got a... they started the trailer doing what they've done with all the trailers, which is we're just going to tell you what the game's about, and then they went into like an actual trailer, which was good. So
kind of spooked me at first. I was like, oh, is this going to be another like cinematic thing? I thought they were doing gameplay.
Yeah, it was weird.
Then it just jumped right in. I was
but
like, oh, okay.
You can go ahead and take the reins on this one.
They released a trailer? What? No. It was really cool. Like I said, at first, it was just kind of like, what's going on? Are they doing one of these, like, teaser videos again? Because they're still, like, really tight on the amount of information they're letting out. Even though they've had the big in 7 day, the Game Informer issue stuff for a month. But they're still, like, holding back as much as possible. Trailer was cool. It was, like, 4.5 minutes.
It was long.
So it was a lot.
Longer than I thought it would be.
It was like a full-fledged fight and then like one part of one conversation. Mm-hmm. So like the actual gameplay of the game, both sort of aspects of it. So
really good. To me, going in, I'm not the biggest Mass Effect fan. Yeah. I'm interested in this game mainly because you guys, but I said it looked like No Man's Sky, except an action version instead of an exploration version. And I like No Man's Sky. That's not like an insult to the game. I really like the combat in this. It looks fun. Like, it looks like I'm going to have a lot of fun with the combat, and it looks like they're even more so than Mass Effect 3. Like, they had some tactical stuff going on. They had that wheel that pops up with different abilities and things, but they also were just, like, blowing things up and doing things that I was like, that looks like...
Yeah,
almost like ReCore, where you can just kind of shoot stuff and have a good time. And if they're able to strike a balance between that, I may enjoy the combat enough to...
Yeah, I think they were just trying to show that this one, even though it's still going to be a cover-based shooter, third person, all that, like, you don't have to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, with a jetpack now, you can dash out of stuff instead of always having to hide. He looked like he had a big, like, biotic Captain America shield during some of that. It was just absorbing stuff before he charged into him again.
Mm-hmm.
And you can obviously, with some of those abilities, dash like way up on top of... There was a guy like in a sniper post or something. Nope, you know, zoom out of that situation. So it was cool. It was like, hey, I don't have to sit behind cover 8/10 of the game.
I don't have to Gears of War the entire game. Yeah. Overall, it definitely raised my impressions of the game, which is good. But as soon as they did the end card, which was, what, spring 2017?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm way more... They would put a date on it if it was coming in March.
I don't know.
I think they would have a date. I think they would absolutely put a date on it. And the only reason I thought, oh, okay, you know, I thought it was going to be at PSX, and that's when we were going to get it, and then it wasn't. And I'm like, oh. So I don't think we're getting it soon. But it's interesting, and I actually hope we don't, because there's a lot of things coming out.
There's a lot of things in March.
That would be a lower priority for me, and I'd rather it come out like at the Metal Gear, like September time, the Metal Gear Solid time came out, where there's typically not much that I want to play. So I get something kind of that I'm...
I mean, even during summer break would be an exceptional time.
If they want to do that, yeah. So that was the big announcement there. Then we moved to PSX, which I couldn't watch live, so I kind of went on a blackout from the media, and I caught a couple things, unfortunately, but I went back and watched the whole thing in its entirety a couple hours after it aired. And they had a lot of announcements. I wrote them all down, but we'll just go through them, too. First off, they opened with Uncharted Lost Legacy, which is, I guess, the single player. They said don't call it DLC. The single player expansion to the game, the single player chapter. They specifically use the words chapter, meaning that there's probably going to be at least a handful of these. Some notes about it. It's Chloe. Thank God. I'm wondering what Chloe was doing
in
Uncharted
4.
We get to see what she's doing. It's longer than Left Behind, which was their first story expansion thing, which you could beat in 2.5-3 hours if you went through it. They said it's shorter than Uncharted 4.
That's a big window.
So it's not 18 hours long,
it's
I guess.
3 to 18 hours.
Yeah. So I don't really know what that means. But yeah, it's a Nadine and Chloe story, which is
interesting. Yeah.
I was not expecting that, so I was kind of like... what? Like, it was just so thrown off because I did not expect that.
Weird combination, but...
And they didn't announce that it was Uncharted going into it. They just showed it. And the reason it was weird is because it's a different camera perspective than Uncharted. It's more Last of Us. It's closer to them. And they're kind of off to the side more, whereas Drake's more in the middle of the screen when he's doing his thing. And it's definitely zoomed out a lot further. In this, it's right up behind her. And the combat looks like it's going to be the same. But since it's got that different camera angle, it's got like a more cinematic
feel to it. Yeah.
So that's cool. I wasn't expecting Chloe, but I will take Chloe. That's the best you can give me. Good job. Next up, Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite. Lots of rumors about this stirred, which kind of sucks. I wish that nothing popped up because this would have been huge. They opened with Mega Man, which is the best way to open it.
Get the worst guy out of the way and just be done with him.
Well, Mega Man wasn't in the last one. That's
for
why
good, for good reason.
That's why it was a big deal. But they opened with Mega Man, Ryu, Captain Marvel, and Iron Man. And it's got the 2v2 fighting. I thought the trailer was pretty weak. Like it seemed like it was almost rushed. It was very like
what's only weak I don't know, like your natural thing is to compare it to like a Smash Brothers, where they've already shown like 12 characters at this point in time, and they just show two on each side.
Well, even like the Mortal Kombat reveal trailer was cool. Yeah. Like I thought like this, like animation wise and stuff, everything was a little stiff. It didn't have that cinematic feel, and like there was no like backgrounds. It was just kind of smoke.
It's a weird like animation and. Yeah. I don't know, just design overall. Like, it didn't look like they just used cinematics for it, and it didn't look right. like they used pure gameplay. It was just somewhere in the middle.
Yeah, like it was like
floating
they,
camera.
Yeah, it was strange, but they showed off gameplay that night.
Yeah, after the finals.
Almost, it was really quick, way faster than I thought it would be. It looked cool. I'm interested in it. I will say that there was supposed to be a character announcement tonight, so we won't have whatever.
I think one for each side.
Yeah, so we won't have whatever that is. Who do you think it is?
I don't know. It could be any number of people. I know.
I imagine they're both newcomers, because I think you want to start off with newcomers.
Well, there's new people, and they're going more the MCU route.
I was gonna say, I think it's Doctor Strange. I think that's
it
the
I
think that's the Marvel one.
Fair.
Capcom. You could do like a new one and then an old one, and then go back and forth. So maybe like
Doctor Strange and Phoenix Wright.
A lot of people are saying Sigma. From Mega Man.
See, I don't think they do another Mega Man one right now.
Oh, not right now.
Even if he's in there.
Down the pipeline.
Yeah. Maybe the Darkstalkers lady. Morgana?
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to say Morgana, Doctor Strange. I don't know. It's out by the time this goes live, though. So, they did a Wipeout Omega collection, which is the Wipeout games. Oh, by the way, Marvel vs. Capcom 2017. Common theme. Almost every game said 2017.
At least with fighting games, you know there's the EVO kind of limit. And
no, this is one I think I'll make it.
Probably like a month or two before. I forget what the cutoff is for games that are going to be at EVO, but you know that one's got a deadline if they're going to play it next year.
So many games for 2017, there's absolutely no way half of these make it. Like, they can't. They're going to be on top of each other. They're going to get like Persona'd where they're just like, move, because we have games coming out. Wipeout Collection. Summer 2017. It's just Wipeout games. It's fine. I'm not a big Wipeout fan. Like, they're fine.
Yeah, whatever.
Destiny has an expansion thing for a week, an event, I guess it would be called. It's a Christmas event. They brought back Sparrow Racing. There's gifts. All 20 people.
Gotta play that.
All 20 people were real excited in the crowd. big one. Crash Bandicoot remastered.
The Bandicoot.
The N-Sane collection or N-Sane trilogy. 2017, the gameplay looked awesome.
Yeah, it looks amazing.
It looks like the old Crash Bandicoot. Like, they clearly kept all the same animations and everything, and they made it pretty.
I really appreciate when remasters do the swap back and forth between what it used to look like, what it looks like, because that's when it like sort of hits you all at once. Because if you look at it now, it's like, oh, okay, because we're used to 3D Mario.
It's what you thought it looked like when you were a kid.
That's what I remember.
That was great. This actually may have been the announcement I was most excited for.
Yeah.
Thinking about it, I was like, oh my gosh. And then later there, they put up a half an hour gameplay thing, and I watched it. And the cutscenes are awesome. They redid the cutscenes. There's voice acting. Crush talked a little bit. None of it was offensive. I was like, this is great.
Mm.
What's her name was in it? I can't even remember from the first Crash game randomly disappears. The girl, it's not Coco. That's his sister, but it's the one that's like sexy for some reason. And then she's just never
seen again.
You need a reason.
It's just weird.
It is weird. But that's still what she looks like. Yeah. I was actually surprised. I thought they might change the story to him like rescuing his sister or something, but no. Resident Evil 7 got an actual trailer. I think this is the first. I mean, there's been some gameplay and stuff online. Some outlets are playing the game, but I think this is the first like official Resident Evil 7 trailer we've seen with gameplay from it. And then they announced the demo gets its final update. There's new rooms to go in. There's enemies in the game now.
This is the most content they've added to the demo.
Oh yeah,
like by far.
And it's in VR now. And I went and I played it in VR for a solid 3 minutes and was like, I don't think I'm going to do this right now.
Why not?
it's a lot. I think it's the best looking VR game for at least this demo.
Oh, yeah.
It looks real good. Enjoyed it. I enjoyed what I played of it. I actually wasn't feeling well in this. I'm going to go back and play it probably tonight. But I think I'm going to play through it normally first and then do it in VR because...
Know where all the spooks
from. If something pops up in that VR thing, I'm going to scream like a baby. That's what's going to happen. Ace Combat 7 got a trailer. Way more story based than I thought this game was going to be. Way prettier than I thought this game was going to be. And of course, they had the VR. This is a flagship VR game for them.
Yeah.
I'm interested.
This and Gran Turismo are the ones where I'm going to be on VR.
Yeah.
Probably most of next year.
I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, this looked really good. And I was surprised that they went the story route with it, but that's a big thing now. Like, you got to be like, we have a story when you do these multiplayer games.
You almost have to.
The last big game that didn't have a story content was, what, Battlefront when it released?
Overwatch.
Overwatch? Kind of. Shooters, you can get away with it sometimes.
Well, Battlefront's a shooter.
Ding, ding, ding. Battlefront Star Wars, though.
That's so true.
But yeah, okay, Overwatch and Battlefront, like, that's kind of a really big thing now.
Yeah, and like Titanfall 2, they were like, we have a story.
We have
a
campaign. Yeah. For the
that was a big
time,
deal.
That's
for
why it was on the list of Game of the Year contenders.
Oh, yeah, it would not have been there. Because it would have been like that versus Overwatch, literally, directly. And it's like, that doesn't work very well. Street Fighter V, Akuma, you're right. I thought Akuma was not going to be in this.
Well,
I guess they were just saying that to get people.
They announced it, and then they said, well, we didn't actually say he was going to be in Street Fighter V, and then they did this. So
he's in Tekken.
Yeah.
And I thought that he was in Tekken and not going to be in Street Fighter, and I actually thought Street Fighter was going to get a Tekken character.
That might have been like a
kind
of middle-of-the-road decision, like, because with the game's popularity doing, you know, up and down all over the place throughout the year, I think they're probably just like, let's hit the Akuma button, and boom, there he
is. That's actually quite possible. Yeah. Last Guardian got a trailer. I skipped it because I'm literally getting this game in a day.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I didn't want to watch it, but it got a trailer. Parappa the Rappa remastered PS4. Did you play it?
The original game?
The demo that came out. Oh, I went and downloaded it. It is so pretty.
Is it?
Yeah, it's awesome. So it's just that first level, the dojo level.
Yeah.
But I went and I played it. It's very, very pretty. Loco Roco also getting remastered, as well as Patapon. These are like weird in-betweens. They're not Crash Bandicoot. Like, they're not remastered like that, but they are... I guess they just redid the textures. It's like a basic
remaster.
There's
only so much you can do with something like Parappa the Rapper.
It's like an
up-res kind of. Yeah. Same with all these games are specifically like that. Like Parappa, Loco Roco, and Patapon are all very stylized games that I feel like you can up-res and it would be good. Though they're actually native 4K, but either way. Looking good. Then they came out with probably the announcement everybody wanted the most cheers. Knack 2. Knack 2 got its big debut.
Yeah.
I was pretty happy.
Sure, man.
I like Knack 1.
There's about two people that like Knack 1.
There is probably about two people, and that's why this one's multiplayer. You got two Knacks running around now, Blue Knack and Red Knack.
You can play co-op now.
What, are you going to have two controllers? Because I'm not playing.
Well, the last one was weird because it was also co-op, but the one person didn't matter at all. They didn't influence the story. They weren't in cutscenes. If the next person ran into the next room, it went without them. They couldn't advance into the next room without that. Like, it was one player, and the other person's like the little kid. You're like, here you go.
Here, just don't
screw up. You can't mess up. This one, actually, it seems like they're important in the story. I'm fine with Knack 2. I think Knack was a fine proof of concept game, and there are so many ideas that even I had that I was like, I would do this, all this stuff. It doesn't look like too much of that's going to be in the game, but we'll see. I'm
holding out for Knack 3.
Yeah. I'm probably going to get Knack 2, though. Then they followed it. Shuhei Yoshida did not come back out on stage. They just played another trailer because they're smart. And it was Gravity Rush 2. Arc of Time, Raven's Choice. This is coming out in March. It is the DLC for Gravity Rush that's going to be free because they delayed Gravity Rush. So this is the, your prize for having to wait. You get to play as Raven, which is a big deal. Raven is the character that obviously it's like they're together a lot in the game. And everybody's like, I want to play as Raven. And then they showed, like, the co-op moves you can do in the Gravity Rush 2. Everybody's like, so you get to play as Raven? And they're like, no. So finally, they were like, they literally came out on stage and went, people have been asking us to play as Raven, so we made this for you. You can figure out her story. And one guy in the audience said, thank you so much.
Yeah. That was actually Kevin, by the way.
It was Kevin, yeah.
May or may not have been. So I was excited for that. Gran Turismo Sport.
Yeah.
Was shown with a new trailer. Like you said, I'm most excited for VR for this. If if any...
And to watch Kevin play a racing game.
I played Drive Club VR for a little bit.
How'd that go?
I spun in a lot of circles.
Exactly.
But I did better in VR than the regular. So that's a thing, I guess. I guess. Spun in less circles in VR.
That's special.
It sure is. The next one, Ni No Kuni 2, was shown off. This was a little surprising because 2017.
Yeah, that seems...
That's
soon.
Not happening. I think this is one that's definitely not
that's
happening.
Ambitious.
Yeah. Looks fine. I'm one of the... Ni No Kuni's like a very, very, very highly... I've been looking up lists and things because we've been talking about doing that top 10 list that we did with the Wii U. So I've been looking at 360 ones and PS3 ones. And Ni No Kuni's like top 5 on multiple lists. And I just didn't like that game as much as everybody else. And the big thing is you fight with monsters and you collect the monsters and stuff. And as soon as they introduce that into the game, I'm like, I don't like this anymore. I went from liking the combat to being like, this is no bueno. But yeah, Ni No Kuni 2 probably not coming out next year. I wouldn't get your hopes up. Yakuza, we're getting, I think, the remaster and then Yakuza 6.
Yeah.
2017 for one of them, 2018 for the next. It's nice that they put a 2018 date on something at least.
It's what they ought to do from here on out.
Yeah, Yakuza's to me are a lot like Assassin's Creed, Madden, things where I'm like, I got it. I'll play one every...
Get one every now and then.
Yeah, and I'm good.
I think they're a little better than those two games, but yeah, there are a bunch of them.
Dynasty Warriors, things like that.
Yeah.
They remind me of that style game. Yeah. Next up, they showed up Danganronpa V3. The Collector's Edition is up for pre-order, and I was kind of upset because it is a laptop bag from the school, which is the same exact thing that Persona 5 did. And I'm like, well, I want the Persona 5 one way more than the Danganronpa one. Like, I like Hope's Peak Academy, but that's unfortunate that they did that. I wish it was like a plushy Monokuma or something.
Well, yeah.
But
just take two bags.
I guess I can do that.
One over each shoulder, yeah.
I went to both these schools.
Got kicked out of one.
But Danganronpa 3, the trailer, big deal. It's on the Vita. That was a thing people were worried about because they brought everything over to the PS4. And then they were like, well, it's because this one's going to be on PS4, similar to what Gravity Rush did. They're like, hey, it's on PS4, and Gravity Rush 2 is a PS4 game. Still on the Vita, also on PS4, so that's good. It looks like a Danganronpa, except more 3D. Danganronpa has a very 2D look to it. You can navigate hallways and stuff, and it's in full 3D now. You're trying to kill other people in this one. You're kind of playing the bad guy as opposed to playing the person who's trying to solve the case. You're trying to kill the people and get away with it, as far as I understand. And there's a bunch more new Monokumas. There's a green one, and there's a blue one, and there's like a red one or something.
Oh, Lord.
So that's exciting for Kevin. Next up, Nier. This is basically, it reminds me of Bayonetta.
Yeah.
It's definitely that like character action game. I think that's the right genre to call it. This is one, I think it's coming out in March, and that is not a good time for me to want to play this game. But similar,
it depends.
similar to Mass Effect, if this, I might pick this up later, or if it gets pushed and it comes out later, I will not be upset because I actually am interested in this game. I like everything I've seen about it, really. But I just know from playing Bayonetta that's not a game that I'm going to want to stay in too long. I like playing those and experiencing them and being done. I'm not one of those people that tries to unlock every outfit, every weapon, all that stuff. So
I might have it, so you can probably just grab it from me at some point.
That works. But I'm interested. Then they did Ease Origin, which is another 2017 game. I don't know if this is a remaster of the original or if it is a new game and they just put Origin in the title like Batman Arkham Origins. Mm-hmm. So it's a little confusing to me as somebody who doesn't play that series, but 2017 big, it's on the Vita. Everybody very, lots of Vita mentioning.
Yeah.
Gio Corsi. And I'm very happy about it. His last time he was on stage, he would say something and he'd pull out the Vita and he goes, and the Vita. And this time he just stayed with the Vita in his hand and kept pointing to it. I'm like, good man. Dreadnought was shown. That's that same thing that I don't really know what it is. They showed a couple games here. This is where I started eliminating games because, A, they were showing games without titles, which was really dumb because there was at least two of them I wanted to play, and they didn't. I don't know what they are. Mm-hmm. Specifically VR games. They showed one. I'm like, oh, that looks fun, and I don't know what it is. And they showed some games that I just... It was too quick. They did a lot of, like, 15 to 30-second trailers at this point, and I... couldn't. I was like, I don't know what this game is. So the only ones I wrote down were Vane, which I don't even know if I can describe, but it's kind of Journey, kind of Ico, real pretty art style in a desert, and there's lots of time manipulation going on. I don't really know what's going on, but that's what I got.
Sounds like Prince of Persia
a little bit. Yeah.
It's got like the little kid protagonist. That's why it reminds me of something like Ico or even Last Guardian, things like that. Then Absolver Online Melee Action, another 2017 game. This looked to me like a better For Honor. I was actually interested in this game, which is surprising. But it's clearly a more indie game, but it had crazy characters. And it looks like a fighting game, like you'll have a fighting game roster, except you're doing this very precise one-on-one sword fighting.
It's like arena fighting sort of thing.
Yeah, it looked cool. Yeah. I'm actually interested in this game, for sure. Another big game that I'm interested in, What Remains of Edith Finch was shown off with the best trailer that it's had yet. They actually explained the plot of the game. It's done by Giant Sparrow, who did Unfinished Swan, which is a game I really, really like. Basically, you're in a house. A bunch of the doors are locked. They're all bedrooms. There's tons of bedrooms in this house. I guess every time somebody is born in the family, they give them a new bedroom and they lock like the old one. Everybody in this family dies like a horrible, tragic death somehow.
Nice.
And you're going through this house and going through everything. And I believe you're playing all the memories of these people that are dying. And you're, I assume, trying to get to the top of the house because there's clearly like a lighthouse thing at the top of the house. That's what I imagine. This game looks great. I'm super, super, super excited for it.
It sounds cool.
Next was Let It Die. I don't know what this is.
I've seen a lot of people playing it, but I have no clue.
There's a skeleton man who talks, and there's like 80s stuff going on. He's skateboarding. people are getting shot at. There's a headless thing. I don't know what this is.
Yeah. That sounds good to me.
It's free. It's out now. You can tell me what it is, because I don't know what it is. And, I mean, I guess I could download it. Windjammers.
Hell yeah.
Which is a disc scoring game, I guess is the best way to describe it. Looks like an old arcade game, an SNK game.
It's a really fun game.
You know this game? Okay. Yeah,
played the original version. It's like, I think they even called it a cult classic or something like that, but it's huge in some like older crowds, I guess.
Oh, okay. Yeah, see, I don't know too much about it. I was like, that looks interesting, but I probably won't get it. But that's coming to PS4 and PlayStation Vita.
Yeah.
Then they went into their VR section, which I thought was very light and I thought very weird because I guarantee you, you're never going to be in a room with more people that have PlayStation VR than that moment.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And I don't know why you wouldn't be like, here's three new PSVR games, or at least like show logos.
Concepts or something.
Yeah, like if you just have Infamous VR or something like that, like get people excited. Yeah. But they showed Starblood Arena VR. It was a... space, not really space. I don't really know how to describe it. It almost felt like submarines, I guess. And you're shooting each other, and it's another multi. It's just like Riggs, just like Battlezone. It's one of those where you're shooting people in multiplayer in VR. And I think we need to calm down on that genre a little bit, because A, they cannibalize each other. The more of them there are, the worse they all get because there's more people splitting up.
Yeah.
And B, I think we should try something new with let's stretch our legs and try something else that's not just running around shooting each other. And I also don't understand the multiplayer VR thing. That drives me crazy. So many VR games are multiplayer, like online multiplayer, and that's like the smallest user base you can possibly have. Especially with their forecast for PlayStation VR, they had it at almost 3 million and they knocked it down to 750,000. That's a big knockoff.
Yeah.
So you stop making online multiplayer games because it's going to be hard to get into a match is my only point. But
it feels like they're just doing the easy games.
Yeah.
Like easy, like just make a multiplayer game or whatever.
Trying to get the roster.
It feels like anything that's going to be like a single player, like experience sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's going to take a while to make. So probably 2018 E3 is when they're like, hey, here's like not Ace Combat and Gran Turismo and Resident Evil things that are going to sell like crazy anyways.
Yeah. And like I loved Robinson's The Journey, and that was a single player self-contained story, and I'm excited for Resident Evil. It controls exactly the same as Robinson, which I was happy to see, except there's a crouching thing, and that's a little weird in VR, like a crouch button.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I'm more excited for that single player thing than the multiplayer one. Yeah. With the exception of one game, which we'll talk about a little later. Neo, which is the Dark Souls samurai game.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really care too much about this game, but you're more interested in it than I am.
Yeah, that's another one where you can probably just grab it for me at some point. Because I doubt
Bloodborne.
Yeah, there's that too. I don't know. It's pretty cool because, I mean, most of the Dark Souls, Bloodborne, all that's kind of, it feels like the same kind of era as far as like weapons and stuff like that you can use. So this one's cool in that it's like completely different area, completely different themes. Japanese theme, obviously samurai, so it's really cool.
Yeah,
how that fits in. I mean, it's obviously not a Souls game, but it, you know, it feels kind of like
similar.
We may not get another Souls game.
We might not.
We'll have to say. MLB The Show 17, to the surprise of no one, was shown off, and it has some retro mode with old school sound effects. Cool. They showed a Horizon trailer, which is another one that I skipped because I was like, I'm probably gonna get this game. I don't need to see it. If I'm on the fence about it, when it's close to coming out, I'll figure it out. I don't really want to see this, so I skip the Horizon one. How are we feeling about Horizon? What's your...
I want to play it.
You want to play it?
Right.
Especially because it moved from Persona. It was a week away from Persona.
Yeah, that was going to be difficult.
Yeah, now
it's more likely to play it now.
Mm-hmm.
If Mass Effect doesn't hit the March date, Persona got moved, and you know, there's a couple other springtime things where it's... I don't know. It frees up some space, it feels like. So, yeah. If those things are on track for what it feels like that they are, then why not play it?
Yeah.
There's nothing else really that big.
And then came out on stage. Sean Layton came out. He said, we have one more thing for you. Very early development. Everybody kind of, the scent was thrown off because Uncharted 4 opened the show. We got Last of Us Part 2. Ellie looking... very good. I like the direction they took Ellie in. It was a really good trailer. It didn't tell us too much, but they did a 30-minute interview afterwards that I very much liked with the voice actors and everything for it. And they were trying to dance around spoilers because there are some little things in there. Ellie's hand has like a shake to it. They're like, why is her hand shaking? I mean, can't tell you that. She's tattooed now.
Mm-hmm.
Can't tell you that. Just a bunch of things, but... she has a line in the trailer that she says she hates them. She's going to kill them. We don't know who she's talking about, anything. But he said that the first game was very much about this, like, compassion and love and bringing these people together. And this one is going to be the direct opposite. It's going to be about hate and tearing things apart. And I think that that sounds awesome. And it reminds me a little bit of Kill Bill. I like how they did Kill Bill Volume 2, and they were like almost different toned, but went together. And I'm hoping that this is Last of Us Part 2, and they're done. Like, this is the story.
Mm-hmm.
That would be great. Also, they were working on this game when they were doing the Left Behind DLC. They were already starting work on this game, so they've been working on this for 2 years now. They're just liars. So they got us good. That's it. That went fine. Yeah, we can do everything. That was pretty quick.
Yeah.
I guess if there's any other quick news stories you guys want to bring up, if you have anything on the back burner.
Anything that was mentioned this week, I completely overshadowed.
Yeah,
so.
that was my problem.
The Guardians 2 trailer, yeah.
The Guardians 2 trailer dropped.
That overshadowed everything.
I hate you so much.
You hate me then.
It was just a teaser trailer, right? It wasn't a real trailer.
No, I mean, it was, what, two and a half minutes?
It was like 2 minutes, yeah.
I don't know what passes teaser anymore and gets in the book. Like, I don't know.
I haven't seen it. So.
But it's another one of those where they show you, like, funny ideas and stuff, but it doesn't feel like you've seen anything from the movie. So mm-hmm. they're still good about trailers, it feels like. So,
yeah, the only other thing that popped up, I know you wanted to talk about Marvel vs. Capcom, but then they actually revealed that. And then No Man's Sky got its Founders update, which is laying the foundation for what the game's actually going to be. They have base building. You can build portals now and teleport from planet to planet. You can build robot machine things that help you, like, mine, and you can, like, place them on all the spots and they'll mine for you. They just added to the game stuff that a lot of people, I feel like, felt should have been in the game from the start.
Like the base building?
Well, the thing is, base building doesn't make any sense in the game. It makes
sense.
Well,
you move around
like,
so much.
The point of the game is to go, go, go. And building a base is weird. That's why you should build a ship, like a huge ship. And then your little ship coming, you know, you want to build the Death Star. Like that is
well,
what
who
you,
doesn't want to build the Death
that's
Star?
That's what you want to do. And you can't do that at least yet. But they said, here's the update. Hope you guys like it. The base building's actually awesome. It works really well. It's probably the best base building I've seen in a game, actually. But it works really well. And they're like, this is the first update. We're going to start adding on to it now. So we'll see how that goes. That was the only other news thing. There was something else, but I can't remember it. So whatever. Moving on, we'll do a viewer question. If you want your question on the show, go ahead and leave it down below. And this is an interesting one. Are there any games that are better if you use a guide?
Yeah.
So
I'm playing one.
Yeah, I know. You posted that picture. I'm like, perfect.
That's fair.
I also have an answer, but go ahead.
Any Souls game.
Mm-hmm.
Final Fantasy. I can probably say any Final Fantasy,
I
would imagine.
I have like seven Final Fantasy guides.
Really? I mean,
I'm not kidding.
I believe
I don't even have some of the games I have the guides
for.
I'm
getting there eventually.
I might.
Anything that involves that many collectibles, anything that involves you need to do this side quest first, which unlocks this, which unlocks this, which unlocks this, like area based.
Mm-hmm.
Because at least Final Fantasy, I mean, this isn't anywhere near a spoiler. You start off in a big area, but everything's barricaded. There's blocks here you can't get through. You can't get through here. And, you know, there's more cities way over here. So it's one of those where once you complete this area and you start to move into one of these other directions, you don't know if you're ever going to come back to that spot.
Mm-hmm.
So me playing an RPG, like I don't want to
get locked out.
Yeah,
of
I don't want
yeah.
those.
Don't want to miss
the classic point of no return where you can't go back and do something because you sort of left it on the back burner. Oh, okay. I'll
yeah,
do
like
this
every
before.
Final Fantasy has that.
Yeah. So any sandbox game, it feels like. I mean, Gran Turismo. I mean, Grand Theft Auto. Saints Row, stuff like that. Who cares? You can just find it at your own pace. And
they're enough, all open. All the, you know?
There's enough icons and mini maps where you can't
really
miss it.
That's the difference for those games. So for me, it's games where you're lost, and that's like the point of the game. And I don't like feeling lost like that. So I use it, even though it's the complete opposite of the game. I use it for things like Shantae and Castlevania, like games where I'm like, just give me a map, show me where all the things are, you can label 1, 2, 3, and that's the order I need to do it in, and that's fine. Like, I like following those games better, because I'll sit there in Shantae and be like, okay, there's a wall here with vines, what am I supposed to do? And I was there for like an hour, and I was like, I'm just gonna freaking look it up, and oh, I was supposed to crawl and throw a fireball at it, my bad. You know what I mean? Like, it's just things where I'm like, I could have just done that and been fine. But then there's other games where I don't, not so much a guide, but just a helpful tool. RPGs, I always look up best grinding spots. Always. Yeah. And if there's like creation formula, not formulas, but like you can meld things together and make weapons or anything like that, I always look up a guide for, because I don't want to be wasting supplies in a game. That's something, if you have limited resources, I don't want to be wasting them and then, oh, your thing, you made a potion.
That's
like,
one of
I
the
mediocre,
biggest common knocks against Final Fantasy 15 is that it does not tell you what's important and what isn't.
Mm-hmm.
So
in the creation, like the meldings, I don't know what it's called.
That too, yeah.
I
but
get it
like,
tomorrow. But
I mean, eventually you start crafting weapons or you need this to make it better sort of thing. And you don't know if these animals you just killed, you know, their teeth or whatever, their husks or something, if that's going to matter or if you can just go ahead and sell it for 800.
Right. That was kind of a problem, not a problem, but Birth by Sleep. Kingdom Hearts has a very similar system to that, where you put two things together and then you can add an item to it and it creates a new attack. And you found books in chests and there was like an advanced one, a basic one, all this stuff. And then once you got all of them, it would tell you what you're making and what it does.
Well, I mean, you recently going through Pokemon, you can probably understand, you know, hey, I just got this metal coat, what is this? Is it important? No, I can probably sell it. And I'm like, no, don't do that.
Every time I got a new item in Pokemon, I was like, what's the shiny stone do? Do I need it? What's
so
this
I followed
Thunderstone
the same
what
logic
happens?
That I do in Pokemon games. A lot of Final Fantasy things, say, can be sold to a shop for a high amount.
A
I'm
high
like,
price, yeah.
Oh, that's what Pokemon does, so I guess I can do it in this game, but I'm sure that'll screw me over at some point.
Very real.
Also, there's a thing in No Man's Sky that I'm not 100% sure. Please don't tell me if it's true. But there's a thing in No Man's Sky that, because it was on the internet, that I think you need to like finish the game, and I totally sold it. So
I don't know.
Oops.
Way to go.
I appreciate
like, it was a key thing, and I sold it. It was worth a lot of money.
Yeah.
And then I'm pretty sure you need it to like finish the game.
I don't know, just anything where I feel like I'm going to have to look this up on YouTube, because I hate that process.
Yeah, exactly.
The people that are
decent... I prefer a guide to the
people
internet.
That are
I like
decent
looking stuff up on YouTube.
Making the videos, like, 9 times out of 10, you're going to get the, hey, welcome to my YouTube.
Please
like,
subscribe if you want more content.
You got to skip 30 seconds of that to watch 10 seconds to find the thing.
Yeah,
oh, it was behind that rock. I didn't look there. And then the last minute is please like, and you know, the usual spin. So I hate that.
The other thing is Robinson the Journey, which I recently platinumed. I played through that game. I loved it. And then I was like, okay, I'm going to platinum this game. I need all the collectibles and stuff. So I was using it to get the collectibles, and none of it was online. And I had to piece together YouTube and Reddit and all this stuff to figure out where the hell these collectibles were. Oh, man, it was awful. But there's just videos on YouTube with 10 views that were 14 seconds long.
Yeah.
That was the exact collectible
just
I needed.
Walking up and buying,
thank you, dude.
Yeah, best content creators ever would do that. But yeah, basically in RPGs, which is... I can't think of an action adventure, like something like Uncharted. I would never get a guide for.
No,
you wouldn't need one,
Yeah. Like, so you could do it if you wanted to go back in platinum and find all the treasures, but whatever.
So, RPGs, it would be Souls games, Pokemon, Final Fantasy. Those are the only real ones.
I always use a guide for Final Fantasy, and then Metroidvanias.
I mean, the hardback one that I got is like a billion pages. The other cool thing about it is sort of a Witcher thing, too. There's so many enemies that have weaknesses to very specific things.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice that they give you what they call a bestiary, and it's like literally all the enemies, what they're weak to, and you know, stuff like that. So I don't have to sit there and scratch my head and figure it out, or use the wait mode and scan them. And just like, that's just wasted time. I'm like, oh, I need
especially
to have...
in Final Fantasy, if that's like a move.
Yeah.
Like, oh, it's awful.
Yeah.
Because you're like, what do you do? And I'm dead.
Yeah. Yeah, or if I'm going into a dungeon.
Oh, look at that guy.
Yeah, if I'm going into a dungeon, I know the big bad at the end is weak to ice or something, then I'm just going to equip the ice thing.
Yeah. Especially some of the bosses in... like Final Fantasies, sometimes they do tricky stuff, and they're really hard unless you know their trick, because the whole point of it is like keep trying until you get it, and that's fine if it's like your only game, but when you're playing through a lot of games, that's an issue. And like, there's a boss in Final Fantasy X where the trick to beating him is to just cast Reflect on yourself, and he'll like start healing things, and like he casts something that like whenever you heal you actually hurt that much or something like that, and you can reflect it and then just hit him with potions and kill him. And I'm like, I never would have thought of that.
Yeah, I would have never thought of
that. I cheesed the shit out of an enemy in Final Fantasy 15. Basically, there's demons that come out during the nighttime. And when it's daytime, they go away because it's sort of like a vampire thing. They start, you know, like getting burned by daylight. There's like a level 42 enemy that popped up. I'm not level 42 by any stretch of the imagination.
Oh, really? Wow.
In this game, you can fight. I think the general kind of guidelines is don't go above 15 levels of yourself. Because if it's a big, dumb, slow enemy, you can just hack away at him and use kind of, you know, tactics to beat him. This thing was like 30 levels above me and kind of didn't want to fight him. But I noticed up at the top of the HUD, it mentioned that daylight was coming soon. And I was like, huh. So I just stood there, dodged him for like 5 minutes, and the sun burned him to death. And
you got the credit for it?
Oh, yeah. That's I got a bunch of XP for that.
I saw the day that game came out, somebody was level 45.
Yeah.
Because they just trained like the whole day. And then they, like, I think they went 17 days or something without sleeping. And then they went to the hotel or the motel and slept.
That's what I'm doing at the moment.
Yeah.
I went from like.
They were like, I wasn't sure how you were supposed to do this, but I'm level 45, guys.
Yeah.
It's
like
I did it right.
Each camp, like, I used it as like a day. Oh, it's nighttime. I'll go camp out, or I'll go to the trailer or hotel, you know, whatever. Because it's really cool because there's story-based things based off of when you go camping and stuff.
Yeah.
So I stopped doing that. I was getting like 2,000, 1,000 XP each time. I'm sitting at 40,000 at the moment.
Yeah.
I'm just going to skyrocket through and find that x3 hotel and be a god.
I'm excited to... So next week, I guess the day after this comes out, Last Guardian comes out. So I'm picking that up and I'm getting Final Fantasy 15. Best Buy has buy two, get one free on PS4 games. So I'm doing that. And then I'm also getting The Witcher 3 to make you happy.
Yay.
And I'm getting...
But are you actually going to play it?
Yeah, I'm going to play it. I'm going to at least try it. And then I'm going to play Werewolves Within. And then I also get another free game, and I'm trying to decide what games I'm going to get for free. But anywhoozle, let's move on to the game releases. Not many this week.
The short one.
Yeah, no write-ups. Gareth had family problems, so we wish him the best. But it's also not a lot, so we can just kind of go over them pretty quickly.
And this is the point of the year where things wind down.
Nobody wants to put out games at this time.
You used to not want to put out movies either, but...
A little different.
Yeah.
December 6th, Dead Rising 4, Xbone, PC.
Dead Rising 4, I don't have too much to say about it. I'm not a giant Dead Rising fan. I like the first one.
Moment of the whole like gaming weekend. I was like, I forget this game's coming out like right now.
Yeah.
Sort of
Last
Guardian you've been waiting for, but I think they showed
10 years.
Something just a while. Where Frank West was sitting in the chair or something like that and showing like cool videos, and then he was like said something stupid and it was like Tuesday. Coming out Tuesday. It's like,
it was a little strange.
Yeah, I hadn't done a good job of keeping up.
And
with
that's one of those Xbox exclusive for a year things that they're doing.
It is what it is. Last Guardian PS4.
I'm getting this one. I'm super excited for this game actually, and I watched like maybe 10 seconds of that trailer that they showed at. I watched Game Awards one, and then they had the one at PSX that I watched like 10 seconds of, and then I skipped through it. I'm very very excited for this game. I really like Ico. And Shadow's good, but I really like Ico, and this looks more like Ico. So,
with a big,
We'll see how it goes.
Yeah,
I might borrow it from you when you're in Final Fantasy mode.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe.
I mean, I'm gonna play this first.
Yeah,
because it's probably gonna be like 6 hours.
Yeah, it's not gonna take.
It's not even gonna come close to Final Fantasy. I'll let you know.
Fair. Shadow Tactics: Blades of the Shogun for PC.
I don't know.
Yeah,
got a cool name.
Yeah, fair. Unspoken for the Rift. VR Sports Challenge for the Rift. Werewolves Within, Rift Vive PSVR.
Yeah, so I'm really excited for this game. This is another one of those I don't know why they're all multiplayer,
this one makes sense for
it. Yeah, it has to be multiplayer, but I really wish that there was a non-VR version because it's VR exclusive.
Yeah.
So this game's cool. It's just like a board game. You're sitting around a campfire. I think it's 5 people. You all have different roles, but you don't know who anybody is. And one or two people is a werewolf. And you can use your different roles and talk to each other, and you're trying to figure out who the werewolf is. And that's the mechanics of the game. So, like, there's a couple things. Like, there's a tracker, and he can lean to his left and lean to his right and hear if the person's a werewolf, like the hill-healer howling. There's one person who's the gossip who will give options over people's heads. Like, they're either this or that. They might be this. Like, so if they're talking and they're saying, oh, I'm a tracker, and then it says maybe the tracker, you know that he's probably not lying about it. There's like the turn cloak, which is somebody who wants to get targeted as the werewolf, and he's like versing everybody, and if he gets picked out to die, he wins, which is an interesting one. But yeah, basically you do that. Some people are just civilians and don't have powers. And then everybody gets to vote on somebody whose vote counts as 2. And if you don't all agree on the same person, then that doesn't happen. And then after 5 minutes or however long it is, you're discussing, you're talking, you can stand up. And if you stand up, literally, you stand up because it's in VR. And then it mutes everyone's mic so they have to listen to you. So you can like make your case and then sit down. You can whisper to people so that only the people next to you hear what you're saying. There's different mechanics like that, but it's really simple. And
there's
then,
a point gesture too. Isn't
there's pointing and facial expressions, which is hilarious. And then at the end of it, everybody votes. It kills the person who got the most votes. And then if that person was a werewolf, civilians win. If the person wasn't a werewolf, the werewolves win. And that's the game. And it's like it's $22 with the Gamers Club Unlocked thing. I'm like, I'm totally... I'll play that for, you know, a couple times and be totally content with that. That sounds great.
Yeah, it sounds cool.
That's a game that I would freaking love all of us to get. Like, we could have 5 people. That would be so much fun, except it cost, you know, $820 to play the game. So that's an issue. I guess more because you need PlayStation Plus, so it costs $870
to
play
the game. And there's no way to do it locally either.
Yeah, I mean, that's fine. I just think that would be a really fun, before bed game, but whatever. I'll check it out and see how it goes.
Last December 8th, Yakuza 6 for the PS4.
Ding. Yeah, that one's got pushed, and I guess is coming out in the the whatever. So
coming out, I think that whatever.
That was the original date.
Oh,
it might be the Japanese one. I'm not sure, but I know it's not coming out then. We stopped using this website, but since Gareth didn't do the write-ups this week, I went back to the old website. I'm like, oh, this is the one that fucks everything up.
And well, there you go.
They fucked up. Whatever.
So it's Kevin's fault.
Let's move on to the unpopular opinion, speaking of Kevin, because this is mine. We're going to have one of my unpopular opinions. This is something that I thought of when I was thinking about... I was doing the 360 list and the PS3 list.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, this is just how I feel. And I have a couple exceptions. And I'm interested to see if you guys agree or disagree. I think you're going to disagree.
Just go through all of it. Exceptions and everything then.
Well,
up front.
Here, this is my unpopular opinion. I think third-person games are better than first-person games in just about every way. And every first-person game could be in third-person. And I think it would be just as, if not more, enjoyable. But if you reverse that, it does not work. So, Halo. I like Halo when I pick up the... Like in Halo 3... where you pick up the turret thing and it goes into third person. I like playing like that. I think that that would be a much better way to play the game. Destiny is a much easier example because Destiny literally has third person sections and some weapons make you go in third person and then it zooms back into the first person. I'm like, man, I wish I could just play this in third person. I liked games that let you switch. Unreal had the first person stuff, but you could do like wall jumping and stuff, which works much better in third person. I feel like I relate to characters much more in third person than the like first person weird kind of nameless thing. This is actually one of the defining reasons I'm getting The Witcher, is because I'm thinking like I'm playing Assassin's Creed and I'm like, I'm enjoying this. I don't think it's like a great game, but I'm enjoying it. And I think it's because that third person thing, I like these characters, and that's part of the reason that and Tomb Raider are part of the reason I'm getting Witcher 3. But I would never, if Witcher, like, that's my problem with Deus Ex. I'm like, ugh, and Dishonored. I don't really
There's
care.
A lot of third person in Deus Ex, though.
Is there really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good to hear. That game's only $20 right now, today. Amazon has a special, so I was thinking about picking it up.
Yeah, I mean, there's cover stuff, there's ability stuff, there's a lot of things that are third person about it, so.
Yeah, and then another point I have is just Mass Effect. I think if Mass Effect was first person, I would not have beat those games. I would have been done on the first one. Like, it just... I don't know. So, yeah, I just think that everything that is in first person would be better if it would be in third person, with a few exceptions I'll go over in a minute.
Go ahead with the exceptions.
Okay, my exception is Bioshock, because it's supposed to be claustrophobic. It's supposed to be horror-based, as well as fear. Another one, these horror games that... Now
Doom?
Doom is a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah, these games that are... more about navigating the environments and not knowing what's behind the next corner, which you don't get in third-person games because you can always peek. But even things like that, you have Dead Space, which is a third-person action shooter horror game that works perfectly fine. Like, you can build them that way. But I can't picture doing Bioshock that way. Like, that world and the enemies and how they work, I don't see that ever working in first-person. So those were my exceptions, but... How do you feel about first person versus third person?
Some games should be first person.
Like what? Like
Halo should not be third person.
Why?
For one, you have a HUD that goes in his helmet. How are you going to see that if you're not in first person? That didn't make sense to me.
Why does that matter?
Because that's how the game's played. You have a HUD. You see your shield. You see your health. You see your ammo. It's all part of the HUD in the helmet.
Yeah, but there's third person games where you can see your health and ammo.
Yeah, but it doesn't make sense to me. You're supposed to be that character.
There's tons of like military shooters that do that.
Yeah, but it doesn't make sense to me. It makes more sense in first person. That's his helmet. That's his display. That's how you're supposed to play that game.
Because it's got the sci-fi.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. It fits in that. It fits in that game.
Well, like you could do it like Dead Space does, which I still think is the best way anyone's ever done it. Where his back has lights on it and has five lights, and as you get hurt, the lights go out, and then when they're all out, you die. And yeah. I'm like, that's a cool way to do it. They integrate their HUD into their character. Back,
I mean, that's fair, but
because of the way that they're doing it. But yeah, I just especially Destiny. Destiny was one that. Like, because I think the opening of Destiny, you are in third person, and then you start the mission in first person or whatever. Because you design your character and stuff, and they don't even matter. Because you
other people see
them.
Yeah.
It's like Fallout. Like, why am I designing my character?
Yeah, any of the faster-paced shooters, I think, are better in first person.
See, I really like Unreal. And Unreal
yeah, see,
can
I never really
person.
Cared for Unreal, so.
So, like, that, because that's a, it's like Quake, it's a little slower.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, I liked Quake more. So
it reminds me of Unreal. Like I liked Unreal when it was in third person and they added swords. Like I thought that was sweet and you could reflect bullets. Another Jedi Academy. Yeah. Another first-person, third-person game where I think the game's much better in third-person than first-person.
Sometimes. Depends on what you're doing.
No, I think it's just always
I played that game mostly in third-person, but if you had, like, a gun, it was better in first-person.
But it's the same thing.
Yeah.
It's the same exact reticle. Like, everything's the same,
except
you can
easier,
see more.
It's easier
you can,
to shoot in first-person.
You can see, I don't think it is. Because you can zoom in. It's just when you hold zoom in is when it matters. Now, I don't actually think that game had sights unless you had a sniper.
I have no idea. I don't remember. Yeah.
But I don't know. It was just something that was bothering me when I was working on my list. I was like, man, I don't like a lot of first-person games, huh? Yeah.
I think I relate to characters more in first-person.
See, that's really strange to me.
Yeah, definitely.
It is?
No, I mean, I agree with you.
Okay,
definitely.
Yeah. Like, I don't know. It, like, gets rid of that line between I'm looking at a character doing swinging from vines or, you know, shooting aliens to I'm shooting aliens. I'm, you know, grabbing the vines, swinging.
So do you not
stuff.
Relate to, like, a movie character, though?
No. I mean, it's different. If it's cinematic, then, you know, you're there watching a story. I don't feel that sort of displacement, I guess, with Mass Effect. I know the fighting's just the fighting. You know, I know that's the game. But when it's the cinematics, when it's the different cut angles and there's the conversations and the options and stuff like that's when I feel like okay I'm seeing something unfold versus I am this guy or I am this girl. I think games like Unreal, like you, they're like twitch shooters for a reason. Halo's a little bit slower and more deliberate. You can
get Halo stuff,
you can do whatever, but I mean it makes sense with what he said because I mean the HUD's literally his helmet, the visor inside of his helmet.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. Where I do like and appreciate games that make it less intrusive, like Dead Space. But like that's one of those games where every inch of the screen matters because something could be coming out of the ceiling, ground, you know, whatever beside you, and you need to see that rather than I didn't see it because my gun logo and ammo count was right there.
Yeah, we're in the way. Yeah.
And it's a spooky game, so you know you don't want all that.
Yeah, most of my examples of things I think work were spookies.
Yeah,
that's just how that.
Yeah, Bioshock, definitely first person.
Yeah, third-person Bioshock would suck.
I don't know. Like, Twitch shooters, you have to have first-person only. Like, third-person isn't going to work. You're going to get motion sick if you try to play Quake.
Yeah, the camera
has
to move way too fast.
And, you know, you need those games. You need those games for, like, competitive stuff, sort of like Overwatch, Counter-Strike.
I think Overwatch would be way cooler in third-person.
I think it would be awful in third-person.
I mean, they can make characters in third-person that would work fine. You know, just give them different abilities and different weapons. That's fine. I mean, there's stuff like, I think some characters do go third person, don't they? Or
I don't know. I only played Tracer.
I hadn't played that game in a while. So.
Yeah, I mean, they can
Tracer's
make,
not
they can make that happen.
She would be
but
terrible
it,
in third
it just
person.
Sort of has to fit. Like, I don't like the games like Ghost Recon, Jedi Academy, like you mentioned, where you can just like click the thumbstick in and zoom back out into third person or like make it. One thing.
Well, typically in those, one of those is always worse.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I think in Jedi, I think first person is significantly worse. I think people would say, like, Skyrim, I believe you can do third person, first person.
Yeah.
You definitely can, like, Morrowind. Third person looks retarded in those games. You're like Minecraft.
Yeah.
That's another one that you can do first person and third person. Minecraft's better in first person.
Yeah, I don't do third person in Bethesda games. It doesn't make sense. And like I said, there's the disconnect between, you know, I'm this guy who can control dragons and whatever. I'm this Fallout survivor versus, hey, it's some dude in a stupid suit. Or
see, that's really interesting. Yeah. I'm the literal complete opposite. I think in first person, I don't care at all about the character because I'm just a TV with a gun attached to it. I'm like, I don't care.
Mm.
But in third person, I don't so much feel like I am the person as much as I'm watching them do all this cool stuff. I'm almost like, hey, buddy, dodge this bullet. Shoot these people. Sweet.
Dodge this bullet.
Yeah. I'm thinking about Drake. That's what I tell Drake.
You tell him to dodge bullets?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Plus, there's some games that are third person only which can't do first person. Like Witcher, you could never play that game. I think games that are hell-bent on look at our environment. Like, you can't do first person in it unless you're like a Far Cry, I guess. But
another game that'd be better in third person.
What?
I think that game would be better in third person.
I don't know. But like the environment rich and hey, you can see our world sort of thing. You don't want to narrow that into just, you know, field of vision sort of thing. You want to see everything around you.
Yeah, you have the vistas and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, if there's any sort of climbing, I think that's actually a big part of it. Vertical works much, much, much better in third person.
Yeah, you can see
they're
where
just
going.
Now starting to do vertical stuff in first person, but I that's something I didn't even think of. Like, you have a grappling hook in Tomb Raider. You have a grappling hook in Assassin's Creed Syndicate. You have a grappling hook in Uncharted. And it's all about climbing things. Yeah. Infamous. You know, you're constantly climbing. You can literally fly. Like, you're doing all this stuff. You can run really fast in Infamous. Those are all things that in first person would not work very well. But yeah,
I
like,
mean, you'd be staring at a rock wall
you're not,
if you were first person climbing something.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Well, like, unless you're in VR, like Robinson's The Journey, where you see the hands and you're climbing. Like, climbing in first, like, climbing ladders in first person.
Yeah.
It's just like a ladder moving.
Yeah, you just see them.
Yeah.
The rungs
so that's interesting. Maybe it's just the verticality.
Well, usually anything with powers, I think, works better in third person. That kind of thing.
Yeah, also they show off a lot better.
Yeah.
Like,
you can see part
using
of effects,
BioShock as an example, like shooting the fire from the hand, or even Skyrim and stuff, like casting spells. It's like, yeah, okay. But then Final Fantasy 15, you cast a spell, it's freaking awesome. Like, it's so pretty and so much goes on and you can see all of that.
Well, especially with that game, with all the dashing and stuff, you couldn't keep up with it in first person.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay. I see. I think I found a middle ground. I still definitely prefer... What do you... To end the show, what do you prefer? First person,
third
person?
Preferred to make sense.
I'm kind of neutral. Whatever fits better.
I like first person because I'm more apt to the Counter-Strikes, Unreal, Twitch shooters. But they're, I mean, obviously, my two favorite franchises slash games are both third person. So it just makes sense. If it's a big open world, visceral, hey, look at, you know, what we've done. Look at this space or look at these crazy hills and countryside, whatever you want to do. It has
did
to
you
be
play
third
Battlefront
person.
In third person?
No, first person.
See, I played it in third person.
Played it first person, almost strictly, yeah.
Yeah, see, I only played it in third
person. Except, you have a lightsaber, then you go third person.
Shooters are weird, because there's stuff like Ghost Recon where you have to adjust your aiming because you're third person.
Yeah, it's
different. When you're first person,
it's
just shoot straight at them, but when you're third person, you have to sort of angle it weird, and when you get in the...
It's a little different.
...big firefights, it's kind of awkward.
But it helps for... stealth and, like, corners
yeah,
and
you
stuff.
Can kinda,
I think stealth is so weird in first person.
Yeah, it's really awkward.
I'm like, oh, you saw
well,
me.
Crouching's weird too.
Yeah,
and all that,
I'm
so.
Like, you saw me because I don't know what's going on behind.
I don't know where I am.
Yeah, third person in shooters is kind of cheap because you can always see around the corner.
Yeah,
so,
I like it. Yeah. But if my argument's always if everybody has it, then it's not really cheap.
I don't know.
Okay, anyway, it's just something I figured we could talk about. Thank you guys so much for watching the Press X podcast. If you made it this far, thank you for being here. Kellen?
Yeah.
Thank you for being here. Nick?
Uh-huh.
And thank you guys so much for watching. We'll speak with you next time.
I want to go watch more Mass Effect now.
What's that?
The game that's coming out soon.
That's not happening.